Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome here. Welcome to this place that we get to call church. Gathered together to worship in one voice, be encouraged, hear scripture. What a great time to be together. Would you stand with me and let me pray to start our morning off. Please stand. Jesus, thank you for the space that we get to be in this morning. Thank you for being present with us, or being a God that pursues us, that walks with us, that gives us the encouragement when we need it. And I pray, Lord, that this morning you would speak clearly and you would be with your people. Whether it's encouragement, whether it's peace, Lord, that you would be the God that walks with us whenever we need. Thank you for being here. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, so we're going to start off with the song, My Jesus. It's that reminder, it's the prayer, it's the walking with, this is who our Jesus is, and getting to join in with what he's doing in this place, in this world. So would you, sing with us. Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all the stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Dreams and wasted years, tell the past to disappear. Let me tell you about my Jesus and all the wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. Who could work it all for your good? Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. The good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. Who would take my cross to Calvary? Pay the price for all my guilty? Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you now. He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love's strong and his grace is free. The good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah, 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 amen, amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. don't you have a seat? I'll invite up Donna.
Wow, let me tell you about my Jesus. What a great morning to gather together this morning. We're on our last day of October, and we have just had a beautiful fall. I was reflecting on that here this week, and I'm so thankful that we just get to experience God's beauty in so many different ways. And this morning now we get to come together as a body of believers and worship together and tell each other about Jesus. And I just love this space where we get to learn and grow together to accept one another and connect. It's a gift. It's a gift to be here together today. So welcome here this morning. My name is Donna, and we're just glad that you were able to come today. I want to highlight a few things that are in your bulletin this morning. First of all, I don't know if the engagement of Lauren Bolt and Derek was announced yet, but I do want to announce that because that's an awesome celebration. That's Warren and Cheryl's daughter, Lauren. So I don't think they're here, but Lauren is in Lethbridge taking nursing. A couple of other announcements. Baptism classes for kids and parents. Today is the last day to notify Rod or Kelsey Lynn if you're interested in that. And it's for kids that might have questions about what baptism is all about and can come with their parents. And so today, if you could notify them, that would be great. And that'll allow them to make plans if they'll go ahead with that class. Also, on November 27th, it's a Saturday, Thrive is having their Christmas extravaganza, and that's going to happen actually here in our church. It needs to look a little different. So tickets are on sale. You can contact Nicole at the Thrive office. They're doing a drama and music. There's a matinee and an evening performance, and I just encourage you to connect and kick off your Christmas season. Come support Thrive. The kids are working on the drama already. I know there's some excitement over here, so I can't wait. There's a gifted group of people there, and it's going to be an awesome, awesome time. So check that out, and if you have any questions, you can connect with me as well. Also, our own event as a church is the Journey Through Christmas, which happens December 10th and 11th, and that's our outdoor event that's happening, and we're still in the need of actors, and we need help with building some sets already. So Kelsey Lynn has the supplies and the ideas and materials, so we just need some hands to put it all together. So connect with her about that. There's going to be a sign-up sheet in the foyer that you can sign up to be involved. I just want to let you know with regards to the acting, that can be a real scary, you know, we need actors. But Wayne did it last year and he was fine. And there's not, you don't have to memorize things or anything, you just get to be. So plug in. We'd love to have you involved. And just a reminder for parents today for kids Sunday school, check-in is down in that main entrance at 10:50, and it's important that you do that at that time before the kids go downstairs. So allow them time to get that ready to go and check your kids in. I think that's all that I'll highlight this morning as we continue to worship. Let's just pray together. Lord, just blessed be your name today. May it just be exalted above all praise. As we gather here together and remember that you alone are our Lord. Lord, you made the heavens and the earth and you have given life to everything. You are faithful and you hear our cries again and again. In your great mercy, you are gracious. Help us to tell others about that, that you are great and mighty and an awesome God. We thank you for keeping your covenant of love to us and being faithful and just. Today may we proclaim you in this place and worship you. Amen.
Let's stand together again as we continue to worship together. Holy Spirit, consider our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again.
Waking or sleeping, thy presence. A new one we're going to sing today called Jesus Strong and Kind. And the first three verses start off with Jesus said that if I, and then responds with then I should come to him. And then the fourth verse is a reply of Jesus says that if I am lost, he will come to me. And it's just the walking through of places that we're in and our response to Jesus, a Jesus who is strong and Jesus who is kind. And so my invitation for you this morning is that if you are resonating with these, that if I thirst, that if I fear, that if I'm weak, that if I'm lost, you would actually follow through with that invitation that he gives you to come to him and to allow him to be the one that gives you that strength to walk in those situations and places that you are in.
Stay and night.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy.
Holy. It is so good to hear that ring out. You are holy and you are Lord. You are Lord of heaven and earth. Amen. All right. You can have a seat. Amen.
We have some little charismatic guy in the back there yelling out amens. I love it. That's awesome. A couple of weeks ago, Wayne and I had the opportunity to head to Alberta to visit my family. And then at the end of our time there, we spent some time in Canmore enjoying the great outdoors, hiking and biking. The weather was beautiful. One evening, we walked downtown for supper. And the moon was just radiant. It was so spectacular, it just stopped us both in our tracks and noticed it. I took out my phone to try to capture this radiant moon. It was this glorious, perfect light situated between two mountain peaks, and it just created a masterpiece. It was beauty. It just drew us to the beauty of it. It seemed to light up the mountain, this dark sky. There wasn't a distinct line around the moon. It just glowed. We were walking down this quiet street. It's very dimly lit, and the moon just reflected off of it. It was breathtaking. It was so captivating. I desperately wish you could have all experienced that with us. And unfortunately, the picture I took just doesn't do justice. So you have to depend on my words, the words I share, to create this picture for you to catch a glimpse of what we experienced that day. It was a moment I wish you knew. And as I was thinking about this, I was thinking of the book of 1 John. The first four verses that we sat on last Sunday highlighted people's words, what they had seen, what they had heard, and it was for others to know and to experience. There's no pictures, but words were used to testify what was seen or heard about Jesus. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Just words about this personal experience that people had to testify about him. So today, as we continue in this book, as Rod shares with us, I pray that we can experience Jesus and just catch a glimpse of who he is, this light in the darkness. And before Rod comes up, I want to spend some time in prayer. We will have a time for quiet reflection, just to prepare our hearts to receive what God has laid upon us today. And before I pray, I just want to highlight a couple of things that I'll pray about. We just want to remember Victor Peters. He is in Ontario in the hospital in ICU battling COVID. And so we want to pray for him. Linda Willems' brother is in the same situation in BC. And we just want to lift those people up, as we know there's many people battling. And also let you know that Jen Willems, Randy and Jen Willems, her mom passed away this week, and so we want to remember them as a family. So just pray with me. Lord, you are a great God. You are our Father in heaven, and holy is your name, and you hear our prayers. And so today we lift up those that we know that are struggling. We think of Linda's brother and Vic that are just struggling and battling. And we just pray that their oxygen levels increase and they don't need ventilators, and take away their fears and help them to trust in you. And I think of Victor away from everybody and the loneliness he may be feeling. We just pray that he feels your presence. And I just pray for Randy and Jen Willems and their family as they mourn the passing of her mom. May they feel your peace in this day, in these days ahead, as they reminisce and remember a lovely, godly woman who led her home. And I just pray that they will feel our support around them in these days as well. And Lord, as we approach the Christmas season, we have the opportunity as a church to present the word of life through our event. And I just pray that we can proclaim you to all those who attend. We pray for volunteers, we pray for the work to be done, and we pray for an effective reflection of the gospel. And Lord, we also pray for our greater community in our world. There's so much darkness and brokenness. There's conflict and challenges. We pray for our governing leaders. Pray for the people who are struggling around the world, whether in persecution or war, or not having food or clean water. Lord, you hear our cries, and we bring these to you. We pray for unity in this dark world. Lord, the world needs your light, and we believe in you, Jesus, as the only way and truth and life. And may you just lavish your love upon us. We thank you for doing that through death on the cross and the forgiveness of sin. I'm always amazed that while we were yet sinners, you died for us. We did nothing to deserve it, but you are faithful. May we be aware of the sin in our life and confess them to you, knowing that you promise to be faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. May your light shine in the dark spaces of our lives and bring healing and restoration Jesus, your name is above every name, and you have overcome the evil one. May we walk in the power of your Spirit within us and proclaim you, the word of life. Amen. Ages 1 to 4 are dismissed for toddler room now.
Right on. It is good to be here. Thanks for leading us, Greg, team, Donna, and nice to see you who are joining us online and you who are in the balcony. I will look up once in a while and look at you. As Donna reminded us, we're into this letter, our journey with this first letter of John, and as she said, it begins with this pure excitement. They're so excited about what they have seen and heard in Jesus, and they're trying to communicate what God has done in history. This real person named Jesus, who they walked with and ate with and hung out with and watched die and touched his resurrected body, that changed everything, because in Jesus, God shared his life, his eternal life, this life that doesn't have any boundaries, with us. So that's what I nicknamed the love line. It's the path that God has made for us amidst the confusion that we can walk in. And God's decisive action in Jesus, it opens the way to living confidently in a fragmented world. And I think we can all agree the world is pretty fragmented these days. So the good news is we don't need to get life right. God has already made it right for us. So last week I mentioned a challenge to you, and if you haven't caught that challenge, here's my challenge. First, read this letter, this book. It's really short, and I would say over the next few weeks to come, read it. Read it over and over in your spare time. Listen to it on an app as you commute to work, whatever it is. Get into it. Just soak in it. Second challenge for you, the level two challenge is I need a few people who would be willing to memorize a section of this letter. And then in December, the last week, what I'd love to do is just have a group of people, through the service, just recite it for us. Like, hear this thing audibly, because that's how this thing was written. It was written to be read out loud. So if anybody's up for that, I've got about 1.5 people so far, and I need like 5 to 10, okay? So step up. You can do it. You can memorize some portion of this, half a chapter or something, and we'll do that. Anyway, that's my challenge for you. I also want to remind you that this letter, it's really cool how it's written. It's amazing. It's not like a book or an argument or a document or an essay. It's written more like music. That's how he writes. It's like rap music in that there's like themes that come up and then drop and then come back and then drop. It's like, you know, Celtic fiddle music that just keeps coming around and around with these regular themes and flavors. In fact, as I mentioned last week, in studying this, there's 30 key words that appear in all but like 3 verses in this whole book. One of these 30 words is going to be in all one of these 105 verses in the book. And so that's the way he writes. He just keeps bringing and recombining. It's like fridge poetry, okay? He's just taking these words and mixing and matching and putting them together. So it's a really interesting book. And last week we saw already 8 of the 30 words. And what we're going to read today, we're going to get up to 15 of them. Beginning, heard, seen, revealed, testify, eternal life, father, son, lie, truth, sin, confess, just or righteous, forgive, and world. We're already halfway through the 30 words, and we're just like a few verses in by the end of today. So that's where we're going. It's just a fun letter, and it's got so much good stuff to share with us. So let me pray quickly, and we're going to read on, okay? Father, we believe that by your Spirit you're here with us, and you're going to teach us, and you're going to show us something through these words written so long ago and yet full of so much life today. Amen. All right. Verse 5, invite you to, if you want to grab your device and follow along, or if you got a Bible with you, do that. It'll be on the screen too. So verse 5 of this little letter, he says, okay, now, after I'm all excited and told you why I'm writing, this is the message we've heard from him, and we proclaim, or literally re-message to you. We forward this on to you. That God is light, and in him there's no darkness at all. Now, this is part of the way John writes. He likes writing in oppositions, like these little pairs of things, and you're going to see that as we go on in the letter. It's like another artistic device he uses. He creates high contrast. You know those photography, that black and white photography with lots of contrast? That's kind of how this letter is. Lots of contrast. But this is his summary of Jesus' whole message. God is light. In him, there's no darkness at all. It sounds a little bit like some words Jesus once said himself. Jesus announced once in the temple, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Now we're like, okay. Donna was talking about light, and we're like, oh yeah, light, of course, light. That makes sense to our modern mind, right? Like light, fighting the darkness, like Luke Skywalker, or Rhea, you know, who after a struggle, they choose the light. Not like Anakin, who chooses the dark, right? Jesus the Jedi, dressed in white, right? That's what we think of, right? He's on the side of his father, who is the light side, right? That's our, of course, obvious, duh. Nothing weird about that. But no, says John. John isn't into Star Wars theology. John has never heard of Star Wars, but John's not into the ideas. He's heard of the ideas behind Star Wars. And those are the ideas that say ultimate reality, the force, can be divided metaphorically into two opposing forces. One violent and seizing and destructive, right? And the other is kinder and gentler and, you know, used only in defense. You know, that's the light, dark versus light. And the goal in Star Wars theology is balance, right? Balance in the force. Between these two principles that are co-equal and co-eternal, right? And they go back and forth. Well, the Bible sees things very differently than George Lucas. They're not the same, okay? Even though they use light and dark. They're not the same light and dark. In Scripture, darkness is the absence of light. It's a negation. And light in Scripture means life. I mean, darkness isn't even a thing or a force. John says elsewhere in his other book, he says, you know, when light shines in the darkness, well, darkness just disappears. Right? Like there's any struggle going on. Struggle there is not. as someone might say. Balance is not possible in light and dark. It's just, there's light. Light is life. Darkness is nothing. In the biblical story, what happens in the very beginning? There's darkness. There's nothing. And God creates the world by speaking into the darkness. And the very first thing he says is, let there be light. And there's light. Because light means there's possibility, and there's possibility of life. So when I say darkness isn't real, I'm not talking about, you know, the beauty of a night sky or the wonder of sleeping in a nice, cozy, dark room. What I'm saying is we don't live in a universe seeking balance between light and dark. God is light, and in him there's no darkness at all because God is life. So the darkness that we experience, the darkness that we find ourselves in, it really should be thought of as blindness. Darkness as blindness. It's the blindness we put ourselves into where we can't see the light, which is the life, which is God. Blindness. Isaiah talks about, he talks about the people, this old poet, right? This old prophet from the Old Testament, and he says, you know, we wait for light, and look, there's just darkness. And we grope like the blind along a wall, like those who have no eyes. We stumble at noon as in the twilight. We're confused. We're confused about what's good. We're confused about God. But then Jesus comes in and says, I'm the light of the world. Follow me and you'll leave the darkness. You'll leave your blindness. And you'll have the light that is life. But that's going to mean you're going to have to leave behind the things that are characteristic of blindness. You're going to have to leave behind the lies and the hiding and the secrecy and the self-deception and the mistrust. All that you got to like let go of. You're going to have to step into the light, which might feel a little vulnerable. Which is what John is going to go on to talk about. And he writes this next little section so cool. He has six if statements. He says, if we say this, and then he goes, but if, and then he says, if we say, but if. Okay, he circles around. It's like, again, like a fiddle tune, right? It just goes around and around. So let's read them. We'll read them all, and then we'll unpack them quickly, okay? So here we go. Verse 6 of John's letter. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in the darkness, we lie and do not do what's true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one, the right one, the just one. And he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. So did you catch them? The three pairs of ifs. If, but if. If, but if. Okay, first one. If we say that we have fellowship, we saw this word last week, it means partnership or oneness or deep sharing, right? This deep sharing. If we say that we have this deep sharing with God, with him, but we're still walking in the darkness, well, we're lying. We don't do what's true, right? If we're still groping around in the same patterns as we always have, well, we're still blind. And we might say, oh, I'm a Christian, I know Jesus. But if we're still walking around like blind people, well, we're still blind, aren't we? But if, John says, we walk in the light as he himself is in the light. Follow Jesus. We step into that places. Because Jesus said, whoever follows me will have this light of life. You won't be in the dark anymore. Well, then it's true, of course. John's just stating the obvious. Of course, then you share in this God who is light, who revealed himself in Jesus. You have this sharing with one another, with all the people who are following Jesus. You have this community, a sharing in the light. Okay. And, John one says, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Whoa. Okay. Blood, sin. Those are new words. Haven't run across those ones yet in this letter. Well, first, let's talk about sin quickly for a minute. Okay. What is sin? Well, last fall, about this time, we had a little series on sin, and we talked about what the Bible says about sin, and we defined sin as this, the HPTMTU. You may remember that, the HPTMTU, the human propensity to mess things up. You got it? The human propensity to mess things up. From little white lies to genocides, it's not hard to look around our world and see people messing things up badly, right? You know? A brother murders a brother out of envy. A spouse abuses a spouse. You lie on that government form. You talk down your neighbor. You're unfaithful to your spouse. You call that kid who's struggling with his or her or their identity, and you call them a mean name. I mean, that's sin. I mean, not everything we do is wicked, but sooner or later, left to ourselves, we blow it, and often with horrible consequences. And the Bible traces that back to our refusal to trust that God, to believe that God is good, right? Well, why would he tell us not to eat this? It tastes good. Why can't we know everything? And the result is we cut ourselves off from God, and who's the source of life. And when we refuse to go God's way, well, it's just death. It's just the absence of life. It's corruption, in fact. There's something rotten in us. And we know it. Or at least we would if we weren't blinding ourselves. We would know that there's something wrong if we face ourselves. So that's sin. And it's a bad state of affairs. And not only in Denmark. It's bad. Now, blood. Why blood? What's blood got to do with it? Well, blood is serious, right? When there's blood involved, oh, there's blood, Mom. There's blood. Right? And you're like, ooh. It's serious, right? Once it's blood, it's serious. Now, Jesus came, as the other John, the one who baptized people, he said when he saw Jesus, he said, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus is going to be like a lamb. He's going to be like this lamb we slaughter at the Passover time to protect us, to rescue us. That's where Jesus' path is going. And so blood here shouldn't be thought of as some magic power thing that you do at midnight, you know, happens. That's religious thinking. That's thinking we need to appease some God's thirst for blood. Rather, what saves us here, and what I think John's talking about, is Jesus' act of radical faithfulness that went all the way to a cross. Right? Jesus took it seriously, and he died bloodily. Right? He died with blood everywhere, pouring out of him. God comes to us and gives his life for us, and blood is shed. But in that bloodshedding, Jesus shows us who God is. He reveals the Father's heart, right? And he says, this God, who you've been scared of and blind towards and not getting and mistrusting, this God can be trusted to forgive. Because look at me. This is who God is. I am God. I'm showing you who God is. And our sin then can be cleansed, John said. We can be cleansed through this. It can be taken care of. It can be wiped out. Our guilt, our shame, no matter what we've done, we can be cleansed from the corruption that's rotting us from the inside out. And that's what we need. Right? The barrier is here between me and God. I'm the one who's run away. I'm the one who's blind and lost in the darkness. I've been selfish and arrogant and neglectful and cruel, and I keep trying to hide it, and I keep trying to keep it secret. No, everything's fine. There's nothing wrong here. But the good news is the blood of Jesus can cleanse me from all sin. Nothing's too sinful for a God who's willing to give up blood. He's like, I know it's serious. I'm going to die. That's how serious it is. And then all we need to do is walk into the light. That's what pair two points out, the second pair, right? Goes this way. It says, verse 8, if we say that we have no sin, well, we're deceiving ourselves, and the truth's not in us. You think everything's good, it's not. If we think we're not caught in the HPT MTU, like everyone else, we're blind. We're still in the dark. But how much? I mean, we do a really good job of trying to cover it up, right? Like we do our hard work and we get new toys and we buy things and we go into relationships and we just anxiously try to get everything right and we blame everyone else for everything, you know. There's nothing wrong with me. They're the problem here. Is it their problem? It's the problem here. John would say, no, that you're deceiving yourselves. But if, isn't this awesome? But if we confess, if we just admit the sin, there's one who is faithful and just, or perfectly in the right. If only we'd stop denying and just walk into the light. Like just walk out there and say, you know what? I have messed things up. Then God will take care of our sin because of Jesus. Jesus was the one who was faithful. He's so faithful. He went all the way to the cross, all the way to the blood. He's perfectly in the right, and he will, just because of who he is, just because of who God is, he'll forgive. He'll release those sins. He'll take them away. And he'll begin this process of making us new and removing all the dirt and garbage. Like, John is writing to people who already believe Jesus. He's not writing to people who've never heard of him. He's writing to his friends who already believed him. And he says, you know what? I'm writing in the present tense. This isn't just in the past. This isn't just way back then. This is today. Today. Don't pretend you don't have sin. But if you confess your sin, there's this faithful one. You have to be like an addict in recovery who's working the 12 steps, which says, I got to take every day a new moral inventory of my life. And I got to pray, just like Jesus taught us to pray, forgive us our trespasses. Yes, today and the last hour. Forgive us our trespasses. And that is walking in the light. And too often Christians shy away. They think, oh, I don't want to confess things because I'm a Christian. Because I should be perfect now. I should have it all together. John's like, no, no, no. In fact, he's so passionate about this, he repeats himself, right? What does he say in verse 10? He says, if we say we have not sinned, he just said that 2 verses ago. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Like, you want to call a God a liar? You want to call Jesus a liar and say, Jesus, you don't have a hot clue what you're talking about. I'm fine. Well, that's not trusting him. The HPT MTU has got us. None of us can claim perfect obedience. We're all caught in it. And that we just admit what's gone on for me. This is my participation in this. Now John slips in a little clarifier there, right? He says, kids, I'm writing this because I don't want you to sin. Right? He's saying, don't just admit your sin and then just stay there either. He's like, well, that would be just ridiculous, right? Don't just say, oh, I sinned. Okay, well, just keep doing the same thing. Like, that's not helpful either. Because he's like, that's blindness again. God wants to cleanse you from sin, remember? Cleanse you. God's not expecting perfection. You can keep on confessing. But you got to keep on confessing and change, let him change your life. He's writing about living with joy. Sin doesn't bring joy, people. Sin doesn't bring joy. It just makes us miserable, makes everybody miserable all around us. So, of course, I want you to begin walking out of your sins. I want you to find life. Okay? So don't pretend, though, that you haven't sinned. Don't make him a liar. But if, in other words, when anyone sins, here's the good news. Two parts again. Here's the good news. He's just reminding us. He keeps coming back to this. He says it this way. He says, we have an advocate who is right there with the Father. Jesus Christ, the right one. So let's pause here for a second. This word advocate, it's a word that Jesus uses about the Holy Spirit. It's this word paraclete. That's the Greek word. What Jesus says the Holy Spirit's going to be for you, it means helper, comforter, encourager. In a legal setting, it means like a lawyer, or an advocate. Or in a royal setting, it means an intercessor, someone who stands in the presence of the king and makes a case for you. Or, I mean, John's point is really just this. We have one who is on our side, who's advocating for us, right? There's one on our side who sits at the right hand of the king. He's the eternal life who is with the Father. And his name is Jesus. And he's perfectly right, in the right. So when you sin, because John's like, of course you're going to sin. I don't want you to sin. Of course I don't want you to sin. Why would I want you to sin? But if and when you do sin, don't worry about it. Because Jesus, who is on your side, is alive. He's not dead. He's not like a... He's alive, and he's at the right hand of the Father, and he's on your side. He's working for you. That's point one. And John always just piles it on. And he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Let's unpack this word, atoning sacrifice, okay? Quick pause on that. The old King James Version used this big word called propitiation to translate John here. You know that word, propitiation? It's a generic word. It just means to appease, right? To propitiate is to appease someone who's not happy. So it's international news this week. Joe Biden was visiting French president to appease him about some big controversy that happened about ships or something, military supplies and stuff. He's appeasing him. He's propitiating. Now, in religions, especially the ancient ones, that used to talk about what you needed to do with God, right? The volcano is about to erupt. We have to throw someone in it to appease the angry volcano god, right? That's propitiation. And we find echoes of that in the system of the religion of the Israelites, right? We see that. God worked within that because that was the way people thought at that time. But with Jesus, things changed. The book of Hebrews explains all that real technically, about how things have changed. And nowhere does John talk like Jesus propitiated an angry father. That is, if Jesus was trying to change God's mind or make God act contrary to what might otherwise he have acted. That's not in John's letter, anywhere to be found. Jesus didn't change God's mind. Jesus is God acting for us. Okay? Little distinction. I'll let you pause and mull about that. But Jesus is God acting for us. And so this word that John uses, one really accurate way to translate it is just simply forgiveness. He's the act of forgiveness. In fact, in Psalm 130, when that's translated into Greek, the same word is used, this helasmos. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, so that you may be revered. The emphasis, when John uses the word, you might say, isn't on the mechanism, the how, but the act. And for John, it's God who acts decisively. He deals with sin. He deals with sin. And so he is the act of dealing with sin and achieving forgiveness for us. And God does it single-handedly, right? Just like the psalmist concludes, he says, Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for the Lord is there is steadfast love, with him is great power to redeem. It is he who will redeem Israel from all its iniquities. God will fix it. God will take care of it. You don't need to do anything. God will take care of your sin. And he did it in Jesus. He is the forgiveness for our sins. So I'm not sure propitiation captures it, honestly, in this case. In fact, probably forgiveness is the best word maybe for that. It's the act of forgiveness. The emphasis is on not on the how, but the doing. So when you sin, this point of this verse is this. When you do sin, there's one who's on your side, sitting at the right hand of the Father, and he's the one who has dealt once and for all decisively with sin. And not yours only, but the sin of the whole world. Do you really get that? Like, sit with that. If that is actually true, on the cross, the sins of the entire cosmos, wow, are dealt with once and for all, finished. Because Jesus took it so seriously, there was blood. And if we could live with that confidence, man, that would be awesome. be so free. It would feel like walking in the light and not being blind anymore, wouldn't it? My sin, your sin, sin of the whole world, God has dealt with it once and for all in Jesus, this one we've seen and touched. So that's where it starts. That's where John starts his letter. He says, you know, whatever barrier you're thinking is there between you and the good creator of the universe, God's done away with it. Doesn't matter what you've done. There's nothing you could have done that God hasn't dealt with. He will forgive you. He is faithful and just, and he will deal with it. He will make you new. So just stop pretending, people. Stop pretending you don't have any sin and step into the light. We might sum it up this way. In our world, we're also desperate to get it right. Get it right. But this is what John's saying. We're never more right than when we admit we are wrong. We're never more right than when we admit we are wrong. And Jesus' life and death and resurrection shows us you're all in the wrong. God is light, and in him there's no darkness at all. We're full of blindness. But to be right, I don't need to do anything other than, yep, I'm wrong. I'm wrong, God. I admit it. Jesus has done what I could never do. He was perfectly faithful to God, and he's on my side. He's on your side. He's working for you, and he's dealt with it. It's all good. Well, I admit my need for him. On John's letter, it's so cool how he doesn't ever then go on and say, okay, now this is how you apply it. It's just one and the same, right? It's just, here's the facts, peeps. People, here's the deal. If you say this, well, you're fooling yourself. But if, that's it. It's just simple and intertwined. And it begins by stepping into God's light. Admit where you're at. And you'll find forgiveness, and you'll find cleansing, and you'll be washed new. And you won't be stained by all that shame, all that guilt. Jesus can deal with that. So will I come to him? That's the question. To give us a moment to reflect on this, Greg and his team are going to come back up and lead us again in that song we sang earlier, Jesus, strong and kind. And the words are powerful in that song. Jesus, strong and kind. Just come to him. Come to him.
We can always run to
come to him. Jesus said, if I am lost, he will come to me. And he showed me on that cross, he will come to me. For the Lord is good.
Jesus, you're strong and you're kind. You understand us. You are tender towards us. And yet you're also so strong and can deal with what's wrong in us. So we come to you, Lord, admitting where we've been wrong. We come to you stepping into your light. May that become our way of life, our everyday thing, to let you draw us into your light so that we don't have to live in the corruption, in the staining, trapped and blind. Thanks for your light. Thanks for your life that you shared with us to the point of blood. Oh, Jesus, we need your cleansing. We need your new life. We pray this in the name of the Father who loves us so much. In the name of Jesus, in the name of the Spirit. Amen. So this week, maybe you need some new habits of admitting when you're wrong. Because it's a way of just renewing yourself each and every day. So I encourage you to look at how you build that into your life. Take some time to reflect and remember, though, that Jesus is strong and kind. So go with that. 10:50, registration for the kids, and 11 o'clock, our adult Sunday class will get started in here and talk some more and live it out and work it out together. Go in peace. See ya.